All right, good afternoon. Let me introduce everyone real quick that's going to be speaking before we get started and just go over quick logistics. So this is the press conference, of course, for the Dirt Bike Task Force. And, of course, we have Commissioner Kevin Davis here. And from the State's Attorney's Office, we have Division Chief for Crime Strategies Unit, Charles Bloomquist, B-L-O-M-Q-U-I-S-T. We have Captain Milton Corbett, who's over my shoulder here from the Special Crimes Initiative Unit. Sergeant Christopher Warren, who's heading this task force. Lieutenant Kenneth Butler, who's from our Traffic Investigative Section. And others from the Police Department, including Deputy Commissioner Paul Meir. So we're going to get started. Just to let you know, I have a couple of videos that we're going to show. And they'll be on the screen, but they'll be available to the media after this event. So just wanted to let you guys know about that. So Commissioner Davis.
Good afternoon, and thank you, Director Smith. This afternoon, we're obviously announcing our Dirt Bike Task Force. This task force was convened just 2 weeks ago to address the ongoing concerns and dangers associated with dirt bikes being driven on our city streets, sidewalks, and parks. What is seen as recreation for riders is known as a nuisance to many in our city. Not only have we seen the reckless driving, but we've seen violence associated with dirt bike riders. Our focus is on illegal dirt bikes. Riders are injuring and killing themselves in our city. They are not wearing protective headgear or any body gear. Just this past Sunday, a man driving an unregistered dirt bike slammed into a parked car. He was not wearing a helmet, and he suffered significant head trauma. What's even more disturbing is his friends who were riding with him left him on the side of the road and took his bike. He's fortunate to be alive today. Others haven't been so lucky. Last year alone, three dirt bike riders died in separate incidents. We have to do this for the families like the family of Allison Blanding. Allison Blanding was killed in a hit and run crash last May by a dirt bike rider at the Cold Spring Metro Station parking lot. Allison left behind her family and a six-year-old little girl. More recently, we've seen incidents of hit and runs and violence. On June 10th, the night of the Beyonce concert on Pratt Street, right downtown, a young lady had just left a local restaurant. She was struck by a dirt bike while walking across the street in front of the Harbor Place. She sustained a fractured skull, blood clot, and bruising on her brain. She was in trauma care for 10 days. On June the 12th at Washington Boulevard and Martin Luther King Jr. Highway, a military veteran accidentally struck an ATV. He was pulled out of his car and assaulted by a group of dirt bike riders. That's unacceptable. On July the 5th at North and Charles, a female accidentally struck a dirt bike. She exited her vehicle to check on the rider. He lifted his shirt and showed her a handgun that was stuck in his waistband and told her to get back in her car and threatened to shoot her. She complied, went home, and called 911. In the past 3 weeks, members of this task force have recovered several guns, some of which you are seeing right now. The next video you're going to see, as Director Smith pulls it up, is a video of a dirt bike rider who is now wanted. An arrest warrant is outstanding for his arrest. What you'll see in this video is a group of, I think, four dirt bike riders before they take off, and they're in South Baltimore. And as the video comes up, you'll see that the young man is in possession of a firearm, and he's meticulously wiping off the bullets as he loads the bullets into a magazine before he puts the magazine into his semi-automatic pistol. Now, the reason why he's meticulously wiping off the bullets before he puts them in the magazine is he wants to make sure that none of his prints are on the shell casings. When a semi-automatic pistol discharges, the bullet travels out of the firearm and the shell casing is ejected. And he wants to make sure that police officers, crime scene investigators, don't recover any shell casings. You see what he's doing with his shirt? He's wiping off his fingerprints and he's sticking those bullets right in the magazine. And right now he just inserted the magazine in the gun and he's gonna stick it in his pocket and he's ready to go hurt somebody in Baltimore. So we owe it to the residents of this city to do something about these issues associated with dirt bikes. We've formed a task force. We're taking it very, very seriously. We're very grateful for our partners in the state's attorney's office for stepping forward and working on this problem with us shoulder to shoulder. We'll be announcing some tip lines that Director Smith will give out, and I'm sure they'll come up on the screen as well. And we look forward to some results. Director Smith, am I turning it over to anyone in particular?
Yes, we'll turn it over to the state's attorney's office shortly, but real quick, this is the suspect that was on the bike that we are now looking for, Jamar Beckford. Of course, we'll ask him to turn himself in. He's wanted. He was the one who was loading that gun. We've since recovered that gun and parts of the bike through our investigation, but we have not yet located the suspect, Mr. Beckford. Again, he's 23 years old. His last known address is the 3400 block of Northern Parkway, and he's wanted on handgun violations and, of course, violations of the dirt bike laws here in Baltimore. So we're looking for him actively. We'll move on, and I'll show you guys this tip line real quick. Much like we've been discussing with the little scooter case, we know that many people who are involved in this and who will provide information on this will do it via social media or text lines. So we're asking anyone with information to text a tip, a photo, video, leave a voicemail at the following number, 443-902-4474. What's most important is that you can remain anonymous. You can also still call Metro Crime Stoppers if you choose to do so, but we will take any type of information, which is where people are fueling up these dirt bikes, where people are storing the dirt bikes, where people might be selling dirt bikes, or even stealing dirt bikes. We'll take that information. This is the language on here is part of the law and part of the statute here in Baltimore that prohibits the riding of dirt bikes and the possession of the dirt bikes in the city. One thing that we wanted to also mention is there's a safety element in it as well, where these are stored inside homes with gasoline. So that's something that our friends at the fire department certainly wanted us to mention, and that's another element of danger that people are putting themselves in by storing dirt bikes inside the their homes. So this is up and running. We have a website that's being constructed where people are going to be allowed to submit tips via the internet and gather a little bit more information, because we're going to be profiling some of these riders who are riding through our streets in a reckless manner. And so we'll go back and show some more of the videos and show some more of the guns if you need that, but turn it over to the state's attorney's office.
Thank you, Director Smith. Thank you, Commissioner. Again, my name is Charles Blanc with the Baltimore City State's Attorney's Office. And just briefly, the reason for the creation of the task force on dirt bikes really is because it is a public safety issue. Not only is it against the law to possess and ride these types of vehicles in Baltimore City, but the correlation between handgun violence and the dirt bike culture is just too much to ignore. We consider this to not only be a safety issue for those that engage in that type of behavior, but obviously then that does correlate to how other pedestrians, other citizens in Baltimore City can be affected by these types of illegal activities. Because of that, we are going to pursue this as aggressively as we possibly can in the courtroom. And again, we consider this to be a public safety issue. Many of these cases obviously are ongoing, so we can't really speak about the specifics, but again, we urge those that do have information to please cooperate with the police force, law enforcement, to help bring this to an end, because again, it will affect and has affected a number of our citizens. So thank you. And Commissioner, again, thanks for the creation of this, and Sergeant Warren, who's done an outstanding job so far. Thank you.
Any questions?
Will there be a change now in the way that you, that police go after dirt bikes? And because at one time, not chasing was the policy. Does that change now? What happens now?
No, there's no change to our pursuit policy. There can't be. There's just too many instances, not only in Baltimore, but across our country, that are associated with police pursuits of dirt bikes. There are other ways to get after these lawbreakers, and the biggest way is to solicit the help of the community. These dirt bike riders, their friends, their family members, they're not bashful about bragging about what they do. They post their information, their pictures on social media. Our task force detectives, led by Sergeant Warren, have a real specific level of expertise, and they will pursue other investigative avenues to identify them.
Commissioner, how large a task force, and what exactly will its work consist of? Will they actively go out and search for dirt bike riders?
Absolutely. So I'll let Sergeant Warren come up and give away some of the trade secrets, but not all of them. It's a sergeant and three detectives. They have significant experience with the auto theft part of law enforcement, and they use various investigative techniques. And a lot of the various investigative techniques that they use lead them to locations where dirt bikes are stored, and you know, we're able to execute search warrants and otherwise recover these illegal dirt bikes.
So they'll receive these tips and follow up on them?
Absolutely. They're already getting tips right now, but we wanted to formally announce the formation of the task force and this tip line number.
We know one of your own officers had a recent incident with a dirt bike rider. How much did that factor into the creation of this task force?
It didn't factor into it. I mean, certainly, like other motorists in Baltimore, collisions have occurred because these dirt bike riders, as everyone in the room has probably seen, I think it's something that we probably all personally laid our eyes on. So it's dangerous, it's reckless, it really scares people when they're at a traffic light or they're traveling on the streets of Baltimore to have these dirt bike riders zig and zag, is that a word, in and out of traffic. And it's a public safety issue, and it's a real issue, and we're taking it very, very seriously.
A couple of questions. Can you walk out a bit more the connection between the dirt bikes and the gun violence? Like, why is there a link there? And then secondly, you're relying on people to give tips, but these guys are quite popular, a lot of them, and people come out and watch this. Don't you think like putting these videos out is just going to make these guys more notorious rather than encourage people to, you know?
Yeah. Well, if that were the case, we'd never advertise anybody who was wanted, right? So we think we have a responsibility to this entire city that we have to identify publicly people who are reckless and people who are prone to violence. They're a lot of them are gun-toting criminals who travel throughout the city recklessly, lawlessly, and with impunity on these dirt bikes. So we're not looking to make a hero at anyone. And in fact, I'd argue that the individual talents that some of them possess, and there are significant talents associated with being able to ride a motorcycle in the manner that some of them ride those motorcycles. And I don't doubt that for 2 seconds. But we encourage those talents to be used in a lawful venue. We think this is dangerous. We think it's something the city is fed up with. And as the city's police department, we're partnering with our prosecutors and the state's attorney's office to do something about it.
And on the gun thing, do they need to carry guns because they fight with one another, or what?
Real quick, one thing we didn't address that Sergeant Warren and Commissioner, as they were talking about this, one of the things that you see in this vehicle are called trail vehicles, and throughout this process that has been going on now for several weeks, it was before the detective was involved in the accident, that we've recovered two guns out of two of the trail vehicles. So this is a trail vehicle. This white vehicle here, they're performing stunts and somebody's there to assist them in a getaway, assist them in videotaping them as they do their stunts. But even they're possessing a handgun. So the possession of the handgun in many of these cases has been synonymous. So we're not, it's not something that's made up. We're getting real guns off of many of these individuals, just like the video. I'll replay the video for you. I don't know if you were able to see it in the back, but I'll replay the video for you where we show a guy actually loading up a gun, cleaning off the bullets that, presumably he was going to use.
Yes. How many dirt bikes are in the city? We know that we have people from outside Baltimore City to come into our city and ride. We will be enforcing the law as well as that. We are currently conducting a lot of investigations to see where most of these dirt bikes are being stored. But this won't be a effort that's going to be completed by the men and women of Baltimore Police Department. This is an effort that's going to take the cooperation of the community. I know that are tired that can't enjoy a Sunday dinner or a walk in the park without 100 dirt bikes terrorizing them.
And what do you say to those people, and by way of making a promise, will they see fewer dirt bike riders this summer, next summer? What's the goal?
I'll let the commissioner answer. Yeah.
So our goal is to not have illegal dirt bikes being ridden on our city streets. That's the goal. Can we get there? Absolutely, we can get there. I think there's a collective resolve in the city to rid our streets of this type of dangerous activity. And as you can see, the folks who are choosing to ride these bikes, dirt bikes, recklessly in our city are often prone to arm themselves, like this young man is doing. So we think that there are connections to dirt bike riding, to violent crime, and we're just determined to identify these folks and have them comply with the law and make arrests when appropriate.
How do you assure the public this won't be a futile effort?
Well, I can tell the public that the Baltimore Police Department is taking this very seriously. We have a task force. We have a real partnership with the state's attorney's office. We have dedicated prosecutors who possess levels of expertise, just like our detectives possess levels of expertise. This is not an easy crime to prosecute, or the crimes associated with illegal dirt bike riding aren't easy to prosecute necessarily. So State's Attorney Mosby and her team has dedicated specially trained prosecutors with significant experience in traffic law and dirt bike prosecutions to work with us to make sure that when we do identify and arrest and cite these dirt bike riders, when they get into a courtroom, there'll be consequences. So public safety is teaming up, and we're gonna do our very, very best.
Commissioner, earlier there was a city council person that wanted to have a park for these illegal guys. I would guesstimate that this probably would squash that or not even have that in consideration.
Well, those conversations are still ongoing, and I think those are healthy conversations about alternative venues. And the police department is certainly willing to, be part of any discussion that's held about those possibilities. But in the meantime, we just can't say you can just ride on our streets until we figure this out. Whether it gets figured out in terms of alternative venues or not in the future is largely irrelevant. We've got a public safety issue going on right now, and we think the best way to go after it is to do exactly what we have done, form a task force, and ask for the community to step up and help us.
What are you advising people to do if they get into an accident with someone, given that there have been some violent incidents with the people who get out of the car after?
Well, whether it's a collision between two motor vehicles or a motor vehicle and a motorcycle or a dirt bike, if anyone feels uncomfortable after they're involved in a collision, and they don't think it's safe to get out of the car and interact with the person who they were just in a collision with, we encourage them to keep driving, pull over at a safe location, make sure other people are around you, call 911 for help. Just because you're involved in a minor collision or otherwise doesn't mean you have to get out right there and confront the person who's involved in that collision with you. So we just ask people, it's a chaotic moment when you're involved in a collision. So I think the natural reaction people have is, well, let me get out of my car and check on this person, or otherwise exchange information with this person, or get together and call the police. But if there's any anxiety associated with doing that, we encourage people to pull over at a safe location, well lit, with a lot of people around, and call 911.
Okay, folks, thank you very much. We'll, y'all can stay put. We'll replay the videos. We'll make sure the desk gets a copy of the videos. Thank you all very much.
Thanks, sir.
All right. Jeremy.